Hey explorers, it's Justin again. Remember, in this unit, you're an urban planner in training designing your own dream city. Last lesson, you learned how to plan infrastructure, which connects your residents to essential services. Don't get me wrong, it's great that you've thought about your city's electricity and roads and all that, but where are the houses, parks, and offices that are connected to this infrastructure gonna be? Urban planners think about this when they plan land use, the ways that a city uses land for different kinds of activity. In your master plan, you decide how your city's land use is structured. Thankfully, we have a resource to help you, urban models. Urban models are theories that explain how land use is structured as a city grows. Urban geographers developed these models after observing the growth of the city of Chicago. These models ended up explaining how other major US cities were growing too. So, why not visit Chicago to learn more about these models? Our visit will help us learn what US urban models exist, how they've changed over time, and how they help us explain a city's land use patterns. All right, explorers, let's get into it. To study urban models, we have to go back to the earlier days of Chicago's urbanization, around the 1910s and 1920s. Urban geographers observing Chicago's growth at that time developed the concentric urban model to explain the city's structure as it grew. Concentric means circles within circles, kind of like the concentric rings of a tree. What do you notice about the land use in the concentric model? This central ring is Chicago's Central Business District, or CBD. Also known as the Loop, Chicago's CBD was the center of commercial activity at that time. The CBD is also the most expensive land in the city, which is why the Loop is dominated by skyscrapers. It's cheaper to build upward than to buy more land and build outward. The second ring, or zone of transition, is mostly industrial land use. Chicago's economy in the 1920s was fueled by secondary economic activities like meatpacking and steel production. So it makes sense that this whole ring is dedicated to manufacturing. The next three rings are all residential use, separated by socioeconomic class. The third ring was mostly occupied by lower income families. Why do you think lower income families lived closer to the factories in the zone of transition? Lower income families were the ones working the factory jobs. The crowded row homes in this third ring were closer to work and more affordable for these families. People in the fourth and fifth rings, meanwhile, had the time and money to commute into the CBD, where they mostly worked in Chicago's tertiary and quaternary sectors. The concentric model highlights a common pattern of urban development: wealth inequality. Lower income families dealt with the crowded residences and industrial pollution of Chicago's urban center. But for the higher income families in the outer rings, population density decreased as homes got bigger and more space was reserved for recreational activity, like parks. The concentric model accurately mapped out Chicago's structure in the 1920s. But it wasn't long before another urban model took its place. Why do you think urban geographers developed a new urban model? As Chicago continued to grow and change in the 1930s, urban geographers noticed that the concentric model didn't really explain Chicago's structure well anymore. Based on new observations, urban geographers developed a new urban model to explain Chicago's growth, the sector model. Compare the sector and concentric models. What differences do you notice in their shapes? Both of these models still have Chicago's Loop as the main CBD in the center, But instead of concentric circles, the sector model organizes land use in wedges, like pieces of a pie chart. A key reason the shape of Chicago's urban model changed is because the city developed new transportation infrastructure, like railroads and streetcars. The routes of these public transit options run along the sector model's wedges. Why do you think Chicago's new transportation infrastructure created these wedge shapes? Chicago's land use developed along the paths of its transportation infrastructure. Lower-income residential areas developed along railroads since it was the most affordable public transit of the time. Industrial activity developed along these same railroads for similar reasons: cheaper land and closer access to transportation for moving goods. Higher-income families settled along the routes of Chicago's electric streetcar system, which directly connected wealthier residential areas to Chicago's CBD. These higher-income wedges had the same benefits that families in the outer rings of the concentric model had: bigger homes, less population density and traffic, and less pollution from industrial activity. Based on what you've seen so far, which urban model do you think supports growing urban populations better? The concentric or sector model? Explain your thinking in your notes. The sector model shows us how transportation infrastructure transforms Chicago's land use. But like the concentric model, the sector model became outdated as the city continued to change. What does Chicago's urban model look like as a modern day city? By the 1940s, Chicago's structure was changing yet again. The model urban geographers developed for Chicago's growth in this era is called the multiple nuclei model. Compare the multiple nuclei and sector models. What differences do you notice between the two models? As its name suggests, the multiple nuclei model shows that Chicago developed more than one CBD. This is because as Chicago's economy continued to industrialize, it developed economic specializations that led to new centers of commercial activity. For example, a CBD called the West Loop replaced an old meatpacking district with modern tech offices. Chicago's O'Hare Airport also became a CBD, drawing hotels and multinational corporations relying on global business. Notice also how residential areas surround these CBDs instead of being separate rings or wedges like in the concentric and sector models. But the multiple nuclei model recreates the same pattern of wealth inequality we've been seeing in Chicago. Lower income residents tend to surround industrial CBDs where pollution is still higher and land is cheaper, while higher income residents tend to live around commercial CBDs. And what about these residential areas super far away from the CBDs? These are suburbs, or residential areas on the outskirts of a city. People still commuted to work in Chicago's CBDs, even if they weren't connected to public transit lines. What transportation infrastructure might have made it possible for people to live in suburbs far away from CBDs? Suburbs were only possible because of highways. As cars became more affordable, more people were able to live in faraway suburbs and take highways to commute to the city's CBDs. And get this, as Chicago's suburbs grew, they started to develop their own CBDs. Why do you think this happened? As suburban infrastructure developed, companies built stores and offices there instead of the traditional CBD, where land is more expensive. When a suburb develops its own residential and commercial centers, we call it an edge city. The rise of edge cities in Chicago led urban geographers to develop yet another model that best explains the city's modern day structure, the galactic model. The name of this model compares the city to a solar system, which perfectly captures its structure. If the city center is the sun, then edge cities and their CBDs are like the independent planets around it. Today, most major US cities look like the galactic model. But as we'll see in the next lesson, this city's structure has its own set of social and environmental issues. So, after seeing all of these urban models, which model might you base your dream city's structure on? Thanks for joining me today, explorers. Before you go, you should know that since these urban models were developed in the US, cities in other countries might have other structures. And of course, since they're models, no real-life city looks exactly like them. Still, the concentric, sector, multiple nuclei, and galactic city models help explain how the land use in major US cities, like Chicago, changed as things like transportation and economic specialization changed. And urban models do help illustrate common urban patterns, like wealth inequality, a part of city life that urban planners like you work to improve. So, what will the structure of your city be? I can't wait to see what you dream up, explorers. In our next lesson, we'll explore what happens when cities keep expanding outward like in the galactic model, a phenomenon called urban sprawl. Until then, keep exploring. See you next time.